Hello and good evening to everybody. To all of our guests here tonight, welcome to Wisconsin Lutheran College. My name is Will Caldwell, and I am the chairman of College Republicans here on campus. For all the students in the audience, we have meetings every other Wednesday in L241 in the library, and we would love to see you there. Firstly, I would like to thank Dr. Aaron Palmer, Barb Westness, Vice President Rich Manisto, Campus Safety, Tim Snyder, and of course the Young Americas Foundation for all of their time and dedication to make this event possible. Finally, I want to issue a huge amount of thanks to our amazing sponsors, Bruce and Kathy Aberly and Jim and Sharon Reinhardt. We really wouldn't have the ability to do this event without their generous donations, so let's give them a huge round of applause. Now, to get started, it's my pleasure to introduce our guest tonight, Kayleigh McEnany. Kayleigh McEnany is the former White House press secretary and current co-host of Outnumbered on the Fox News Channel. Prior to serving in the White House, Kayleigh worked as the national press secretary for the Trump campaign and formerly the national spokesperson for the Republican National Committee. Prior to working for the RNC, she also worked as a political commentator at CNN. With an extensive education background, she graduated from Harvard Law School with a Juris Doctor, Georgetown University School of Foreign Services with a degree in international politics, and studied politics and international relations at Oxford University as well. She has a new upcoming book, Serenity in the Storm, Living Through Chaos by Leaning on Christ. We are excited to hear from her tonight, so please join me, everybody, in welcoming to the stage Kayleigh McEnany.
Hi. It is wonderful to be here. I had an early walk-on moment, so your enthusiasm is contagious, so thank you for having me. Let me set this. Well, it's great to be here in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Now I'm at Fox News. They just had the GOP debate here. Did any of you get to attend or see? Wow, great stuff. It was a lot of fun to watch. Well, it's wonderful to be here. A lot changed in my life pretty rapidly. I went and became White House press secretary and then went on to be a co-host of Outnumbered on the Fox News Channel. That's at noon every day. For those of you interested in watching. But I will say, even more than the changes in my life, there have been a lot of changes in the Biden White House. In fact, not just the press secretary that has changed, but the questions from the press corps have changed. I don't know if you watch the White House press briefings. If you don't, I watch several of them for you so I can bring you the most important parts. But I will say it was a bit jarring to leave my job as White House press secretary. The press, I don't know if you ever watched my briefings, but there was a lot of vicious attacks coming from the press corps. And to watch the change in the press corps when there was a change in the press secretary. So Jen Psaki was my successor. She took over the job when I left. And here were some of the questions she got. It was really interesting to me. So this is real questions. This is not Saturday Night. This is not Saturday Night Live. This is not parody. These are questions from the White House press corps to press secretary Jen Psaki. Could you just give us some color about what it was like for Joe Biden when he walked into the Oval Office? He's been waiting for this for so long. What was his reaction? I would have loved to get a question like that. Never got it. Will Biden keep Donald Trump's Air Force One color scheme? Again, not a question I ever got, one that I would have loved, and I'm sure I would have nailed that one. Can you clarify for us what happened with the president's dog? There have been some reports that one of them was involved in a biting incident. And then my personal favorite, any update on the White House cat? Again, not questions I ever got. Here's what Jim Acosta, Caitlin Collins, and the like were asking me. Let me ask you if I can, Kayleigh, why does the president keep hiring people who are dumb as a rock, overrated, way over their heads, wacko, and incompetent? Real question. So you use the phrase warriors to describe everyday Americans fighting the pandemic. The president's using that phrase as well. What's the thinking behind the description? is that basically asking Americans to put themselves in harm's way like warriors do. No, I'm pretty sure the president was just praising Americans fighting through the pandemic by calling them warriors. Nevertheless, that was a question. And then there was this one where you can see me flipping through the pages of my binder if you go watch this on YouTube, and you see me just stop flipping and stare in utter bewilderment, because the question I was asked was this: does President Trump believe that it was a good thing that the South lost the Civil War? Real question. Dumb question. They say there is no such thing as a dumb question, but that is indeed a dumb question. But let me back up a little bit and talk to you about how I got to the White House podium. I grew up in a place called Plant City, Florida. It's a small town. For those of you who've not been there, it's called the strawberry capital of the world. It's right outside of Tampa on the west coast of Florida. Beautiful little town. I grew up going to the Little League field with my parents and riding to school in Tampa. And what framed my political thinking was riding in my dad's truck and listening to the late, great Rush Limbaugh. I don't know if any of you listened to him growing up, but I recognized boldness and truth and forthrightness and courage, and it framed my political worldview. Meanwhile, on the spiritual side, I grew up sitting in the pews of my Southern Baptist church, and I learned about my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, which informed my faith worldview, which overtakes my politics any day of the week. But my dad, you know, he used to say to me growing up, Kayleigh, what's your worldview? What's your worldview? And I looked at him with a little curiosity, you know, what is worldview? My dad keeps saying this. It sounded like this esoteric term just in the atmosphere. But I realized exactly what he meant when I left my little small town, my rides in my truck with my dad, and I went to Georgetown University and Harvard Law School and these very liberal institutions, and especially when I went overseas to Oxford University. I spent a year, my junior year in college, I transferred, so I basically did an entire year at Oxford under their grading system, didn't go to my home school of Georgetown. And the reason I sought out Oxford is because they have this system called a tutorial system. So when you write a paper for college, you know, you'll get it back with a few markings, a letter grade, maybe you go to office hours, talk about it with your professor. Well, at Oxford, you write your paper, and you are forced to read it out loud, word for word, to your professor, who's called a tutor, and they grill you on it. And if you think my press briefings looked tough with Jim Acosta, no, it was way tougher with a well-credentialed PhD grilling me on international relations. Well, I go to Oxford, I write my first paper. It's this beautiful town, they call it the City of Dreaming Spires. There's these, it's like a castle-like structures everywhere. And I go to my first tutorial. It's in a library, and it was a church-turned-library that is set literally in a graveyard, which is very appropriate because that's how it felt. As I walk up this 12th-century spiral staircase, climb the staircase, get to the perch of this tower overlooking the City of Dreaming Spires, I begin to read my paper out loud, and to say I am annihilated is an understatement. I left that tutorial in tears, because I was so grilled, didn't have the answers. I felt I didn't live up to my potential in that moment. And this tutor, I found out, had a very different worldview than my own. You know, I was an Israel-loving, Western, Republican, conservative, and I found out she was a former member of the Palestinian Liberation Organization, the PLO. Very different thinking than me. Nevertheless, she became my favorite tutor while at the university. She made me better, and while I never changed my views, I became more certain in my views, in fact, she challenged me. I became better. I became stronger. And I take from that a lesson that I think is meant for all conservatives on college campuses. You know, no matter what you're going through, if you're in a professor, you don't agree with the ideology, we have an advantage at being young people. I'm a millennial. You guys are Gen Z. But being among a generation that is very left, sometimes being on college campuses that are very left, we're advantaged because we have to give footnotes, facts, statistics for the reason we believe what we believe, for our worldview, where it's very easy to be a liberal among Gen Z. It's very easy to be a liberal among millennials. It's not so easy to be a conservative, but we're made better for it. And my press briefings were informed by my time where I was forced to give footnotes there at Oxford University. But fast forwarding, so I spent my time at Oxford. I get back to Georgetown, I did internships on Capitol Hill, I did an internship in the White House in the Bush administration. That was incredible. I was in the Office of Media Relations, and I was this young kid, you know, college kid, running around the White House, and I'll never forget, I got to go to one press briefing during my time there, and Dana Perino was the press secretary. So I'm this young kid in the back of the room, staring at Dana Perino, watching her answer these questions, never knowing that 10 years down the road, I would be the one giving a press briefing. It's a path that God had for me. It's not something I really set out to do. I knew I wanted to be in politics or media. Never did I have my eye on press secretary, but it's incredible the way God works, because that was clearly his plan for me. And that moment, being an intern in the White House, was part of that plan. So fast forward, I ended up going and doing several internships, as I mentioned, on Capitol Hill in the White House. I took a job as a production assistant at Fox News for Governor Mike Huckabee. He had a show at the time. I end up going to law school, and as fate would have it, President Trump wins election. I was someone who, I was on CNN while in law school, and if you ever watched CNN during the 2016 election, they had these like 10-person panels. I don't even know how you fit 10 people on a set, but CNN manages to do it. I was this little blonde girl on the edge of the set, a law student, and there were 9 people who were essentially liberals, all of them, even the hosts, all liberals, and I would give my conservative point of view and get battered and shouted down. But I gave my position, and I gave it with facts and footnotes and data, something I had learned to do at Oxford. I leave CNN after the election. I end up graduating law school. I go, and I'm RNC spokesperson. Then I go to be press secretary for the Trump campaign, and that's where everything changed. So I'm press secretary for the Trump campaign, and I end up getting pregnant. I'm so excited. I got married. I had my first little baby girl named Blake. And I'm traveling the country trying to figure out how to be a new mom and a campaign press secretary in the middle of a presidential election. And my mom, she travels the country with me. We go to Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina with my little daughter. She's just a few months old. We're setting up makeshift cribs and hotel rooms, trying to figure out how to do this thing as a working mom on the campaign trail. And then all of a sudden, COVID-19 hits, and just like that, everything shuts down. So that meant the campaign kind of went dormant. We didn't shut down, but I went back to Florida. And I will say, if you had to lock down, Florida's a pretty good place to lock down on the beaches of Florida. So we locked down there. I'm riding across a bridge. So this moment in my life, a huge moment, my daughter's in the back seat. She's there, my mom's driving, and I get a call. So when the White House calls you, it's an odd series of numbers. It's not your traditional series of numbers. It's a few digits short of that. And you kind of recognize the White House is calling you. I had received 2 calls prior to this moment from the White House switchboard, and I recognized this was likely the White House, probably the president. So I said to my mom, I think the president's calling me. And I put a pink pacifier in my daughter's lips, and I answer, and they say, this is the White House switchboard. We have a call for you from President Trump. Can you take his call? No one's going to say no. So I just pray my daughter doesn't cry. I answer the phone, it's President Trump, and he says, I have a question for you. And I thought it'd just be, you know, a question about something I had said on television or an article I'd written, but instead he said, would you like to be my White House press secretary, taking me totally by surprise. And I said, Mr. President, that would be the honor of my lifetime, to which he said something like, Mark, get it done. I think that meant Mark Meadows, go get it done. And Mark Meadows indeed got it done. I take this job, it's in the middle of COVID-19, a once-in-a-generation pandemic, and I get a little apprehensive. I know I can do the job, I know I have the ability, but it's, you know, a humbling moment realizing that you're going to be communicating with the American people at a perilous time like this. My husband and I decided to ride up the Eastern Corridor to Washington, D.C. I didn't want to go on a plane because I knew if I was caught on a plane, someone from the press may see me and say, new press secretary on the plane during COVID-19, endangering the life of the president. So I just wanted to be cautious. So I'm riding up the Eastern Corridor with my husband, and I have all these apprehensions. So I'm trying to figure out how best to do this job. I'm calling people in the White House. I'm calling former press secretaries. I even tried to find academic journal articles about how to be a good press secretary. There are like 1 or 2 that exist. I read them. And then my dad texted me, and he had sage advice, as he always does, and said, Kayleigh, maybe you were made for such a time as this. Obvious reference to the book of Esther. And I believe sometimes when God wants to send you a message, he'll send the same message, sometimes through 2 different sources. So my dad said this to me, and then a few weeks into the job, someone very opposite of my dad ideologically, but common spirituality, both Christian men. This time it was CNN's Van Jones, who's a liberal, who said, "Kayleigh, maybe you were made for such a time as this." And I believe that message, it was meant for me in that moment, but it's a message that's meant for all of us. We're all here in a moment, in a time, in a place, with a plan that God has for us for such a time as this. I get to Washington, D.C. My first day on the job is April 13th, 2020. It's pouring rain outside. Not ideal. I had to walk the perimeter of the White House in pouring rain. I get in, it's still dark outside, and I sit in the press secretary's office, realizing what an enormous task this is, not quite knowing how the day would go. So the day begins, and I get a call about midway through the day. I believe it was from the chief of staff's office. "Kayleigh, go to the Oval Office. The president's going to do a coronavirus task force briefing. Go brief the president before his briefing." So I go to the Oval Office, first time I'd ever stepped inside. Yes, I'd been an intern, but I'd never physically stepped inside the Oval Office until this moment to brief the President of the United States, quite something. I walk in and I walk past this grandfather mahogany clock off to my left. I walk on the sunbeam pattern rug. It was a Reagan administration product that President Trump put in the Oval Office, this big rug. And I sit on this gold couch across from the Resolute desk. The Resolute desk was a gift from Queen Victoria, I believe around 1880, to the United States. It has this big eagle carving on the front. And I sit there, and President Trump takes his seat. And one of the challenges of being someone in communications or press is you have to learn how your boss consumes information. And in this case, I'm having to learn on the job. I don't know how President Trump gets ready or briefs himself or prepares. And I quickly realized he wasn't spending a lot of time focusing on the questions. He was spending a lot of time on his opening remarks. He had a binder kind of like this, and he was looking through the binder and making edits to it and looking at his opening remarks. And I thought to myself, we're not going to have a lot of time to brief him. Like, the briefing's in mere moments. And he stands up. He's about to go to the briefing room. And I say, "Mr. President, I know what you're going to be asked today." And he said, "What?" And I said, "Well, Dr. Fauci went out on CNN and he made some remarks that are being spun out of context to suggest that you did not mitigate for COVID early enough and you should have acted sooner because you could have saved more lives." That's the way the press is spinning it. And he said, "Well, Kayleigh, what would you say in response to that?" At the time, I had all the facts in my head and I said, "I would say, Mr. President, on January 6, 2020, there were no cases of COVID in the United States and you issued a travel notice for Wuhan. There were zero cases of COVID in the United States on January 17th. You issued public health screenings at three major international airports. Only one case of COVID on January 21st. You opened an emergency operations center. And there was not a single death from COVID-19 on January 31st. And you issued a travel ban on China, one that your opponent, Joe Biden, called xenophobic." He looked at me and he goes, "Go type that up." So I run to my office, type it up as fast as I can, give it to him, and it's the first and only time I saw him read verbatim something I had written for him word for word. And I thought, well done, except I realized in hindsight, I think he was just doing it to make the newbie feel welcome on her first day, to make me feel welcome. But nevertheless, it was a good first day. It had been, though, 400 days since a press secretary had ever stood at that podium, because Sarah Sanders was the last, and there was kind of this lag period. I didn't know if I'd ever get a chance to do a briefing, but then one day the president looked at me and said, "Kayleigh, I want you to do a briefing." And I thought, okay, I need to give myself time to prepare. I want to create a perfect binder, tabbed. You know, that was going to take some time. And the binder, it's actually interesting, it became a subject of interest to reporters. In fact, they had a camera right behind me and they would take pictures of the binder. And one time CNN posted my binder with the tabs. The headline was "Decoding the Mysteries of Kayleigh McEnany's Briefing Book." There was really no mystery to it. But one day we thought we'd do a head fake, and instead of like COVID, vaccines, therapeutics, we would do Jim Acosta, Caitlin Collins, you know, John Carl, all their names so that they'd know that they were being in check. We never did that. That was a regret, but you know. Anyway. So I wanted time to create the binder, but the president said, "I want you to do a briefing." He said it on like a Wednesday, then he said it again, then he said it again. And finally on Thursday, he said, "I want you to do a briefing and I want you to do it before Friday." Like, okay, this gives me 24 hours to get my stuff together. So we got it together, prepared late into the evening. We would sit about around a wood-burning fireplace in the press secretary's office. I had two great aides, Chad and Julia. We would sit for hours and hours and hours and talk about every conceivable question that could be asked. Oftentimes, we would identify the hardest possible question to answer. The press never asked that question, though. I'd always have it ready. They never quite asked that question. But we got the podium, it was mechanical. We got it to 37 inches, the exact height, and I had put in all of the preparation. But the human preparation is one thing. The more important thing was the spiritual preparation. And the evening before my first briefing, I listened to a Joyce Meyer sermon about faith over fear. I tweeted out Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I listened to Christian music. I get into the White House. But trepidation begins to take over, a lot of worry. It's obviously a big moment before you walk to the podium for the first time. People start texting me with pieces of advice, encouragement, Christians who are saying that they've been praying for me. One person who texted me was my predecessor, Sarah Sanders, and she sent me pieces of advice. And the last piece of advice she sent me was, most importantly, pray. Let God carry you through the tough times, give you strength when you don't have any wisdom. And she said every time before she walked to the podium, she read her Jesus Calling devotional. And it's a tradition I carried on. We also prayed as a team. It's the last thing we did before we walked out together. And that day, my first briefing, May 1st, 2020, she sent me her Jesus Calling devotional from exactly 2 years prior, May 1st, 2018. And it said this, "You are on the path of my choosing. There is no randomness about your life as you give yourself more and more to a life of constant communion with me, you will find that you simply have no time to worry." But as I mentioned, I worried to the point of almost being in tears in my office. My assistant got my mom and my dad on speakerphone. We prayed together. And when I walked to the podium, I felt a total and complete serenity. That is not anything that I did myself to have that serenity. It was because there were millions of Christians around the country, people of faith, who prayed not just for me, but for our entire administration. And I want to thank you if you were one of those people, because we felt your prayers. They made a difference. We should pray for our leaders, and we should pray for those in Washington, because I can tell you it makes a difference. It made a difference in all of my briefings. That being said, you know, my briefings, the goal was three-part. One, I wanted to convey accurate information. Two, I wanted to put a spotlight on Americans. And three, I wanted to expose some of the gotcha questions from the press, and I anticipated there'd be many. It's pretty remarkable, though, when you look at some of the things the press said in hindsight. And this is one of the frustrations when you're someone who's been in a role where you're communicating information. With Republican administrations in particular, the press will spin things wildly out of context, sometimes completely mislead the American people. And when the facts come out many months later, there's no accountability. So an example for you, and this is why I decided as a press secretary that the theme of my press shop would be offense only. We're going to go on offense. We're not going to stay on defense. But when you look at some of the hindsight analysis of the press and their questioning, it's a pretty dim view of modern day journalism. So NPR declared, when I was there as press secretary, that this was about Lafayette Square. This is the area right outside of the White House. And this was during the summer of 2020 where there were protests, there was violence. You all remember. So they declared that peaceful protesters were tear gassed to clear a way for Trump to take a photo op in front of a church. That was the headline. Indeed, the Washington Post, they said, inside the push to tear gas protesters ahead of a Trump photo op. In fact, the Post even compared it to Tiananmen Square. They said from Tiananmen Square to Lafayette Square. I was asked this by Jim Acosta. Kayleigh, you mentioned Dr. Martin Luther King. He likely would not have approved of what took place Monday, even across from the White House, as you probably know. If the White House, the president, and his team had to do it all over again, would you have gassed and pummeled protesters to clear the park so the president could have a photo op? That was the narrative. Many months later, President Biden's in office. What happens? Inspector General for the U.S. Department of Interior, not a right-wing news source, this is the Department of Interior Inspector General finds, we determined that the evidence did not support a finding that the U.S. Park Police cleared the park on June 1st so that President Trump could enter the park. So it was totally false, as confirmed by an inspector general. Then you move forward, there's a story, it was the Russia bounty story, and the story was that Russia had bounties on the heads of soldiers in Afghanistan, and President Trump did nothing about it. Okay, that's a pretty serious allegation. Imagine that, our service members, bounties on their heads, and their commander-in-chief did nothing about it. And I said, this intelligence is not verified, there's no consensus, in fact, there are dissenting views. I said to the press, before buying into a narrative from the New York Times that falsely states something about the president, wait for the facts to come out. President Biden, at the time, just a candidate, he accused Trump of dereliction of duty. Well, in hindsight, that did not fare well for someone who allowed Afghanistan to fall to the Taliban. We lost 13 of our heroes at the Abbey Gates on President Biden's watch, but he nevertheless accused Trump of dereliction of duty. But oh wait, 10 months later, what do we find out from the Daily Beast, a left-wing news source? U.S. intel walks back the claim that Russians put bounties on American troops. It was a huge election time story that prompted cries of treason, but according to a newly disclosed assessment, Donald Trump might have been right to call it a hoax. COVID lab leak, again, another narrative. Hunter Biden, remember his laptop, not verified, it was Russian disinformation. Oh wait, now we know it's been verified by basically every single news organization. So that's what we're up against, is a press that is willing to mislead. And this is why facts and truth and light and offense only is important in communications. As we close here though, I would be remiss to not mention this important election we have ahead and the importance of all of you in this room, the importance of Gen Z. You have enormous power. You have enormous, enormous power. 2022, the midterms. Gen Z voted at higher rates than previous generations. Your generation, you guys vote. You hold power, you wield power. Times takeaway from the midterms, how Gen Z held off the red wave. Gen Z, your generation, not you in particular in this room, but your peers, your colleagues, those you associate with, determined the midterm election. 2020, the same story. And when you break down ideologically how your peers voted, in 2020, 60% of 18 to 29-year-olds voted for Joe Biden. It was the most Democrat-leaning age group in the country. But here's the good news, if you're someone who's a Republican or a conservative. This group, once Biden's best demographic, has now shown the largest drop in support. In fact, Gen Z's approval of President Biden is at 37%. And the main word that your peers are using to describe the president is ineffective. Ineffective is the word. And CNN, you know it's not good for the president when they say, it's a hard sell. And that is quoting a Gen Z activist who was warning that there's a lot of frustration among Gen Z towards this president. One thing I think that's important for Republicans is to meet your generation where they are. Social media, TikTok, Twitter. This is important and the left knows it. So important, and it's amazing to me that this has not been a major, major news story in conservative media. This is in the Washington Post. Days before the midterm election, you all determined the midterm election results. Days before the midterm election, what was the president doing? President Biden spent more than an hour that week at the White House with 8 TikTok stars with a combined following of more than 67 million. That's enormous. Who were brought to Washington in hopes that their posts will turn out votes for Democrats in the November 8th midterms. Not only were these TikTok influencers brought into the White House, they got an Oval Office meeting, they got a session with former President Obama, they got a tour of the Supreme Court, a tour of the Capitol, they met with the DNC, and they met with the DCCC. Democrats understand how to meet your generation where they are via TikTok, via social media. In fact, Biden's White House has the largest ever digital team, and the person that was the head of that digital team was elevated to the highest status in the White House of special assistant to the president. They understand the power of social media, the power of meeting this generation where they are. But the method is just as important as the message. I would get into the economy, but we only have time here for just one issue, and so I'll just go to the issue that is number one for your generation, and that's the issue of abortion. When I talk about the power of young people 18 to 29 years old, Washington Post's Linda Lake, she's a Democrat strategist. These are the facts. So you have these ballot initiatives throughout the country on the issue of abortion. Well, in Kansas, women under 30 turned out to defeat the ballot initiative there, turned out to vote pro-choice at a rate of 41%. Kansas had the highest voter turnout ever for a statewide election in a primary on the issue of abortion. People are turning out, young women in particular, voter registration is skyrocketing. In Michigan, youth midterm turnout was 49%, and 69% of voters younger than 30 voted to put abortion rights protections in the state constitution. But here's the good news. We can win on the issue of abortion. In fact, a Gallup poll, the most recent one, showed that 37% of the country wants abortion banned in the second trimester. That's 13 weeks of pregnancy. So when you listen to these candidates on the stage here in Milwaukee talk about 15 weeks, the majority of the country thinks abortion should be illegal, with exceptions, at 13 weeks. But we lose because of some of the nomenclature by the Democrats. The Democrats are very good at the messaging battle. But here's where Republicans, I challenge my party, there are 3 points that I maintain if we put forward, we can win on this issue. And it may take some time, it might not be tomorrow, but I think in time we can win it. Number one, we have to message with compassion. We have to take a compassionate point of view. For instance, when my successor, Jen Psaki, was asked at the podium, should a baby at 15 weeks, is that a baby at 15 weeks? To be clear, a baby at 15 weeks, their eyes are closed, but the baby can sense light. Their eyes are moving rapidly. They have arms and legs. They have a heartbeat. The baby has a separate DNA code from the get-go. Well, at 15 weeks, the baby is a baby. But Jen Psaki declined to say that the baby is a baby. And in fact, if you look at the inhumanity of the left's language, my successor Jen Psaki said recently she compared the pro-life movement changing their name from pro-life to pro-baby. She compared pro-baby to broccoli and lumps of coal. She said if you take a lump of coal and you tie a ribbon around it, it is still a lump of coal. Well, I can tell you I had a little lump of coal in my stomach last year. His name is Nash. He's not a lump of coal. He's not a piece of broccoli. He's a baby. We can win by exposing the inhumanity of the left on this issue, and we must. Stacey Abrams said she's the failed gubernatorial candidate, twice failed down in Georgia. There's no such thing as a heartbeat at 6 weeks. It is a manufactured sound designed to convince people that men have the right to take control of a woman's body. Okay. I went to my OBGYN at 5 weeks. I heard my son's heartbeat. I saw it on an ultrasound. My husband was sitting next to me, and I can tell you there wasn't a cabal of doctors in the office putting the sound in the room to convince me that my husband controlled my body. No, that was not the case. But here's the scary world we live in. Stacey Abrams says that. Planned Parenthood, around that time, had on their website that a baby has a heartbeat at 6 weeks. But all of a sudden, they changed the language on their website. And they said, it sounds like a heartbeat, but it's not a fully formed heart. It's the earliest stages of the heart developing. So Planned Parenthood, you'd expect them to change the science, despite March of Dimes, the Journal of Medicine, everyone saying there's a heartbeat. Planned Parenthood tried to change the science. Here's the scary part. This is before Elon Musk took over Twitter. You all know the trending section in Twitter, where it says the most popular stories, the most talked about names, and it used to give a generic description as to why that term was trending. Stacey Abrams was trending. Here was the agnostic, supposedly, description of why her name was trending. GA gubernatorial candidate Stacey Abrams said there's no such thing as a fetal heartbeat at 6 weeks of pregnancy, and doctors agree one does not exist during the early stages of pregnancy, reports from NBC and NPR confirm. So what just happened? They changed the science. They changed it on social media. The mainstream media, NBC, changed the definition of the science. And doctors, all of a sudden, agree. Everything changed to support a Democrat candidate on the issue. But the truth is, we must speak compassionately about this and ask our peers, do we want to be in the camp of North Korea and China on abortion? Do we want to be one of 7 countries in the modern industrial world that allows abortion after 20 weeks? Or would we rather be like our peers in Western Europe? I would take the latter rather than being lumped in with North Korea and China. Number two, we must support women during pregnancy. Our party doesn't talk about this enough. Senator Rubio said men should be paying child support to women from the moment of conception, and he wanted to legislate this with federal legislation. We must support women during pregnancy. We've got to bring down the cost of childcare, the child tax credit. We need to be the party with not just the pro-baby agenda, but the pro-mother agenda. And there's a way to do that. And the final point on the issue of abortion is we have to expose the extremity of the left. Governor Gavin Newsom was asked this week, is there any limit on abortion? Any limit whatsoever? He declined to say there was any limit on abortion whatsoever, though he was asked 6 times. Kamala Harris was asked about 4 times during an interview. She declined to name any limit. And you'll hear the left out there saying, it's a farce, it's a fallacy that we want abortion until birth. Well, the facts are this. The Women's Health Protection Act allowed abortion until birth. All a doctor had to do was cite health. Health can be mental health, it can be anything. Literally, just go to the doctor and the doctor has to give you an exception for health. 49 Democrats voted for this piece of legislation. 49. Only Joe Manchin joined Republicans in stopping it. 49 Democrats voted for abortion until birth. Even worse, the Born Alive Survivors Protection Act said if a baby is born outside of the womb, we have to give that baby medical treatment. Basic human rights tenet, right? 210 Democrats voted against babies outside of the womb receiving care. Outside of the womb, viable babies who survive an abortion. We've got to expose the inhumanity of the left because I will tell you this, it is not a woman's right to choose. It is a baby's right to live. And we have to be unequivocal on that. And as we close here, you know, these political issues are important, and I believe the issue of life is an outgrowth of faith. But more important than any political issue, this is a heart issue. We need to have a revival in this country. There has to be a cultural shift. And it starts with person to person and the person of Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you my salvation story. I became a Christian as a young girl. I walked down the aisle. I gave my life to Jesus Christ. But my faith became real to me right after college. I moved to New York City. And New York City, despite having millions of people, can be a very lonely place. I went to a place called the Journey Church. And my pastor there, he said, despite millions of people being here, you can feel like you're the only person on planet Earth. And I definitely felt that way. So I'm at my job one day, and I leave a little early. I was feeling down. I went through a bad breakup, which at the time seemed so important. In hindsight, I laugh, but at the time, it seemed big. So I leave, and I try to call my mom, my dad, whoever will answer. No one's answering. So I get home. I'm laying in my bed, and I said, God, if you're here, I need to hear from you right now. And in that moment, I got a call from a number I did not know, and I answered it, and they said, this is the Journey Church. How can we pray for you? We feel we need to pray for you. And I know that was an emissary from Christ that in that moment was used. I don't know if it was a man or a woman. I don't remember the person's name. But God used that person to reach me. And my faith went from my head to my heart. And it's always been there and it's never changed. And I will say it's very cool to get a call from the President of the United States saying, will you be my press secretary? But it's even more impactful when you get a call from the risen Savior through someone here and it changes your life forever. But this is my story. This is the way God has used me. And he thinks the same of you. As Luke 12:7 says, indeed, the very hairs on your head are all numbered. Do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. God knows the number of hairs on your head. That is how much he loves you. That is how much he knows your identity and his plan for you. Jeremiah 1:5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you before you were born. I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. He knew you before he formed you in the womb. This is my story, and you all will have a story in life, and God can use you in a pretty powerful way. In the same way my dad and Van Jones said, you're here for such a time as this. All of you are here in this moment in this room, and you will be used for such a time as this. So thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
In the Okay, there we go. We will now begin the pre-submitted Q&A questions. So the first question we have here is, do you think AI-generated content, particularly in regards to false information and deepfakes, poses a threat to presidential candidates in the upcoming election?
I do. I absolutely do. You know, certainly politics, as they say, is a blood sport. People will use every tool at their discretion. But I think it's very frightening when you have technology that, on one hand, can be life-saving. I was talking to a doctor this week at how incredible AI is for radiology, so we can diagnose things, we can find things on ultrasounds that the human eye could not, so that's exciting. But at the same time, the idea that a voice could be emulated, the idea that you could have a DeSantis or a Trump or a Nikki Haley who looks like them but says something that is that's antithetical to their message or what they stand for, I do think it's a big threat. I do think it's something that we should watch out for, and I don't think it's something that campaigns should be using, particularly because it can be so misleading.
Cool. Okay, so the second question we have is, it seems the Republican Party has embraced the myth that incrementalism works, especially regarding social issues. You mentioned this, most importantly, abortion, i.e. a six-week ban or a heartbeat ban versus complete abolition. When will the Republican Party reject compromising our core principles in a futile attempt to win a broader appeal to the voting public?
That is a very smart question, whoever wrote that and asked that, and I wish you could get into the minds of our candidates on that one. You know, I think the biggest mistake, one of the biggest mistakes in the 2022 midterms is Republicans hid away from the issue of abortion. It was controversial, there were fault lines. You know, I was talking to a pro-life activist out in Ohio, and he said to me, you know, we had polling for decades on the issue of abortion and Roe, and it all involved courts and, you know, overturning Roe, and how would that look with an electorate? And he said, think about this. All of our polling for decades went out the window. We're in a new terrain. So we now have to say proactively what our policy should be. Should it be at the state level? Should it be at the federal level? What should it look like? How many weeks? What are the exceptions? But instead of addressing this and having a view as a party, most candidates have just hidden away from it. They try to avoid the question, but we need to be proactive about it. And I think the point about incrementalism is a good one. You know, there are candidates, DeSantis passed heartbeat legislation in Florida, DeWine did in Ohio, Kemp did in Georgia. We've seen this passed. And all of those governors went on to win re-election, not just win, but win by double digits. So there is a way to do this and to talk about it, but when you see a party that is hiding away from even 15 weeks, some candidates are unequivocal about it. Tim Scott is. He says he'll sign the most pro-life legislation that crosses his desk in the Oval. Mike Pence is very forward on the issue. And Mike Pence is being very smart on it, I would argue. In fact, he instead of started saying weeks, I noticed he started saying, when a baby feels pain, this should be banned. So think about that. Instead of talking about the number of weeks, why are we not asking the left, who wants abortion until birth? We just went through Gavin Newsom. We just went through Kamala Harris. Why aren't we asking them, President Biden, Kamala Harris, Gavin Newsom, when does a baby feel pain? They could not answer that question. If you asked Joe Biden that on a debate stage, do you think he could answer that question? Of course he couldn't. If you are a baby that, of course he couldn't. I mean, let's be honest. He barely knows his name most days. But if you are a party that wants abortion, you should be able to answer the very simple, humane question of when does a baby feel pain and how does that factor into your abortion equation. They're not thinking about it because they don't have to. It's a humane question, and we shouldn't, to that point, engage in incrementalism. We need to own the issue, and owning it means what I did at the podium, going on offense, offense only. We got to stop playing defense. We need to get on the offense as a party on this issue.
So the next question we have is from Hilario De Leon. He's the 22-year-old chairman of the Republican Party of Milwaukee County. And he asked, as a member of Generation Z, what advice do you, well, I guess from his perspective, what advice do you have for people in my generation that are just starting to get involved in politics and eventually stepping up to become leaders in the overall movement?
So number one, I would intern everywhere that you can. You know, I have built a network of people in life through internships. And an example is, you know, right out of college, I was a production assistant, so I'm at the lowest tier, you know, at Fox News where I went to work. But some of the people I worked with there are now still colleagues of mine. You know, I went on, I left, I went into politics, and I came back. But some of my colleagues, when I was just a young little kid running around the newsroom, are now colleagues of mine still to this day. And the same goes for politics. Some of the people who I worked with at the Republican National Committee, I was just on the phone yesterday with some of them, talking about this issue. You saw Governor Shapiro in Pennsylvania, who said he wants automatic voter registration. Well, I dial up my contacts from, you know, a previous job, and I get their perspective on the issue. So my point is, when you intern, you get a vast array and network of contacts. And it may seem like the political world is big or the media world is big. It's actually very small. So gather contacts at your internships, go above and beyond. You know, a lot of times you go to an internship and it's just you're pushing papers, you're not giving a meaningful task. Well, find a meaningful task. I remember in one of my first internships, I wasn't being given a lot of responsibility, so I thought to myself, how can I make this person's job easier? And I decided instead of just sitting around, I would try to write the opening script for the show. So I started writing it, and I would set it on the person's desk every day, and finally the producer said, this is pretty good, and let me start writing it. He would obviously edit it pretty heavily, but started to let me produce the segment. So that applies in politics and media. Go do an internship, go get a first job somewhere, go above and beyond, get that network of contacts, and use it. And you know, I would also say, if you're in politics, because that was the main question, yeah, is politics, make sure you have your facts. So rather than saying a point, I am pro-life and here's why, and have footnotes for everything you believe, every issue you look at, have footnotes, facts, statistics, have a reason for the fact or the opinion that you're giving, and it will take you very far in life.
All right, so the next question is, can a woman balance a career and a family? If so, how and what would that balance look like?
That is a fantastic question. I think it's a lot easier if you have a support network. My mom is incredible. My husband is incredible. I could not have done half of what I do without them, but you can do both. And the one piece of advice I give to people, and I hear this a lot from young women, I have this desire to be a mom, but I have a desire to have a career. You don't have to give up one or the other. God finds a way to make it work. And I learned that pretty quickly when I got on the Trump campaign. I literally had just become press secretary. I thought, what a better time than to get pregnant than right when you get the dream job of your life. So got the job, became pregnant, and just had faith that it would all work out, and it all did work out. But you'll always have helping hands, and especially being in the Republican Party, we are a pro-family party, and I learned that pretty quick when I was at the Trump campaign. Having a baby, I would bring the baby into the campaign. There were girls next door who'd come in and watch Blake for me and help out, and I'd go to a meeting with the boss, and everyone chipped in and everyone helped, and when there wasn't family there to do it, there were colleagues that would step up and help. We're a pro-family party, and I think that's embraced throughout political campaigns. I think that's embraced throughout our party, and it's something that I'd love to see our party extend outward and embrace young mothers around the nation. So if you have the desire to be a mom, do not give it up. If you have the desire to have a career while you're a mom, do not give it up. You can do both, and especially now, I would argue now versus a few decades ago, we're a society that embraces working moms. So do not give up either dream. God will make it work. Trust in Him. That's what I did. It all worked out, and it will work out for you.
All right, so the next question is, how is the Biden administration making it easier for us to appear vulnerable to our international enemies, i.e. China, Iran, Russia?
I mean, that question immediately, what comes to mind is the fall of Kabul, the fall of Afghanistan. That was, what a moment. You know, President Trump, I remember hearing a story around the White House that he would pick up the phone and talk to the head of the Taliban, and in pretty heavy terms, I was told, say in no uncertain terms, if an American soldier dies, there will be repercussions. And he said it a lot more strongly worded than that. So they heard, They listened, and in the final months of his presidency, not a single American soldier was killed, because they knew that there would be hell to pay if, in fact, an American soldier was killed. Well, bring in President Biden, and President Trump had negotiated an exit out of Afghanistan with conditions. There would be conditions. And if those conditions were not met, there would be no exit from Afghanistan. It was not an artificial timeline. It was not, let's get out by the 20th anniversary of 9/11, as was President Biden's plan. It was a conditions-based withdrawal. Well, when President Biden withdrew prematurely, the conditions had not been met, but withdrew, and 13 American soldiers were killed at the Abbey Gates, and the Taliban raised its flag over Afghanistan, and there was that image, and it looked like Saigon as people were being evacuated. China saw, Russia saw, North Korea saw, and in that moment, they knew that they had a president who was weak on the international stage, a president they could railroad. And that's what we've seen, and we've seen it on every front. Look, the UN General Assembly happened this week. Who's not there? China's not there. Xi, at one point, the president of China, would not even take the president of the United States' phone call. We have a president that has shown unfettered weakness on the world stage. It began with Afghanistan, and every single moment after, our enemies have disrespected this president, they've disrespected our country, because strength, peace through strength, is what we saw in the last administration. But now we are getting violence through weakness, and that's an unfortunate state of affairs in the world.
All right, what do you think will be voters' top issues in 2024?
The economy, number one, no doubt about it. And the president's marks in the economy are in the 30s. So the economy's number one, but I say that with a big caveat. You know, they used to say it was James Carville, the Democrat operative, who used to say, it's the economy, stupid. The economy wins or loses elections. But I put a big caveat on that because the midterms, it wasn't the economy, stupid. The president had very poor ratings on the economy. You know, inflation sky high, gas prices going up, interest rates high. If you're a young person who wants to buy a home, a car, good luck. The interest rates are horrible. But the economy was poor. The Democrats still, by and large, prevailed in the midterms. Republicans underperformed. So while I say the economy is number one, I think, no doubt, the abortion issue is a big one. Education is a big one. We saw that in Virginia with the election of Governor Glenn Youngkin. Republicans do not win on education. We never have historically. We did in the state of Virginia in 2021 with Glenn Youngkin. There are wedge issues that I think are going to be very important. But one, and it's not necessarily an issue, it's more a mechanism, one thing that's going to be very important in determining the results of the election is mail-in voting. The rules of the game have changed. COVID, we saw states change. Mail-in voting is now enormously important. The Democrats are very good at it, Republicans not so much. But I have a lot of faith in my conversations with the Republican National Committee. They have a new operation called Bank Your Vote. So in a state like Pennsylvania, when you have 50 days of early voting and Republicans aren't voting early and we count on election day, you know, people don't always show up if their child gets sick or something happens. We have to start banking our vote, banking mail-in ballots. So I'm convinced the party is working on it. Ronna McDaniel's doing a great job. But as important as any issue, I think it's going to be the mechanism and making sure that we get those mail-in votes, because that's the new name of how to win an election.
All right, so this will be our last question. This question isn't specifically from me, but from the person that submitted it. They say, what can I say to liberals when they posit that LGBT relationships are as valid for marriage and adoption as normal, i.e. heterosexual relationships?
So what can you say? Repeat that last part.
What can I say to liberals when they posit that LGBT relationships are as valid for marriage and adoption as normal relationships?
You know, what I would say is this. So the issue of LGBTQ and marriage, Obergefell v. Hodges was the decision by the Supreme Court. So that was the law of the land. So the marriage issue has been settled by the Supreme Court in the same way the life issue has, and we respect the rules and edicts of the Supreme Court. When it comes to the issue of adoption, foster care, I volunteered in the foster care community. It is horrid, horrid conditions that these kids live in. I remember there was a young boy that I would read to a beautiful young boy named Antoine, and I remember the sister there of this foster community, and there were very few adults there. These kids essentially had no figures to look up to, no love, nothing in their lives. The sister said to me that this little boy looked at her and said that he wanted to be eaten by an alligator because that is how sad he was in life. This was an 8-year-old boy. So I think the issues when it comes to foster care and adoption should be focused exclusively on the child. So rather than getting involved in these, you know, arguments of adoption, I think at this point in time, the sole focus should be on improving the lives of foster kids, adoption facilities. Something notably, when's the last time you heard Congress talk about that, by the way? They don't talk about it. Because guess what? Young kids in the foster care community do not have. They don't have money. They can't donate to politicians. They don't have votes. So before we reach the argument of adoption and the way it should look, we need to focus on improving the lives of foster care, of these adoption facilities. And I would focus, I would change the argument to focusing on, in fact, the child, something that our leaders, unfortunately, have not done. Thank you.
All right, so that concludes our event. Kayleigh, I just want to thank you for coming here, lastly, obviously. That concludes our event. Let's give one more huge round of applause for Kayleigh.
Thank you so much.